Welcome to the First Pentecostal Family Worship Center Sunday Experience. We thank you for joining us. And now, get ready to experience the power of Pentecost.
Well, God bless you and praise the Lord. It is a wonderful day that God has blessed us to be on the air on today. And we thank God for you joining the First Pentecostal Family Worship Center. I am Pastor Elmer Hess, Jr., and I pray that you are doing well, you and your family. I pray that you have prepared yourself for worship on today. Listen, I need you to do me a favor. I need you to make sure you're ready to praise the Lord on today. Come on, let's act like we're in church today so that we can have church. We can experience God's presence and God's glory. That's our theme for the month of November. Welcome to November. I tell you, this year is moving. It would seem for some not fast enough, but yet it's still moving fast. And our theme for the month of November is that we would experience God's glory through following godly vision. Where there is no vision, the people perish, but he that keepeth the law, happy is he. Proverbs 29 and 18. That's a very familiar passage of scripture, but as we were preparing that theme for this month, God began to speak to us. And in one version, it says that because we can lose our vision, we can become discouraged. And this is not the season to be discouraged. This is the time to set our eyes upon the vision that God gives us. And we'll be unpacking that throughout the month as we read our Word of God throughout the month. We're going to look at what is godly vision and how do we properly follow godly vision. And I thank God for you being a part of the service on today. Remember that you can share the link and you can invite someone to join us as we worship the Lord at www.firstpen.org. You can just let the people, your friends, your family know that we are on the air. We're going to prepare ourselves for prayer today. I tell you, we have a wonderful service prepared. Today is Communion Sunday. We invite you to get your juice. Praise God, we have our juice and our cracker. Amen. We're ready to go on today. We're going to be serving communion at the end of our service. As always, we want to remember the death, the sacrifice of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ, what he did for us. And communion is the way that we do that. And we also celebrate his resurrection. Because of that, we have eternal life. And Jesus told us to, as often as you do this, you do bring glory and praise to the Lord. And so we thank God for you on today. It's time for a prayer. We have the missionary evangelist, Yvonne Powell, is with us on today. God bless you, evangelist.
God bless you, pastor. It's good to be here.
All right. We're glad to have you today. And you're in your white, your official attire for communion. Amen. And
amen.
We just thank God. You know, we're in a season, evangelist, that we didn't see coming. But we are adapting and we are still giving God glory even on today and in this season. And so we're going to ask that you would just pray and encourage the people
yes,
to join you in prayer as we worship the Lord on today. God bless you.
God bless you. I thank God because here we are, the first day of the week, the first day of the new month. And it's not a better way to do it than to begin with God. Then to begin serving him and looking to him, praying to him and seeking his wisdom for us. Amen. Bow your heads with me and let's pray. Dear Heavenly Father, we want to say thank you for what you've done. We want to say thank you because you're great and you're mighty and you're awesome. Oh God, we thank you because there's none like you. You are God, amen, and there is none else. Hallelujah to you, oh God, because you deserve the highest praise that we can give. Oh God, we just thank you for what you have done, how you gave your son for us, Lord, to die for our sins, oh God, so that we can be joined together to you, oh God, and we thank you for that. We say thank you, we say I praise you, and oh God, we're gonna look to you because you are the beginning. You're the first and you're the last. There is none like you, and we just thank you. And oh God, we seek your face. We seek to know you even the more. We seek to do your will, Lord Jesus, and to be counted as one of yours today. So we just say thank you, Lord Jesus. And we ask, Lord Jesus, that you would just touch and strengthen. Oh God, bless those, Lord Jesus, who need you on today. And we all need you in some way, oh God. So I ask that you help and strengthen, encourage the hearts today. Help them to hold fast, not to give up, not to give in, not to throw in the towel, but to lift up the banner for you, Lord Jesus. We can lift up the banner of holiness and righteousness. And we just say, thank you, oh God. We thank you for what you've already done. We thank you for knowing, Lord Jesus, that your word will never fail. And we thank you and praise you that you've given us one more day, Lord, one more day. And we thank you for that, Lord Jesus. We thank you for our families, how you've watched over us and have taken care of us. Lord, through danger, seen, unseen, not knowing, but oh God, we know you. And you said that you would take care of us. You would provide for us. And we thank you for doing just that. And oh God, we look to you for those who need encouragement and strength. They need help today, Lord. Help them to look to you. Oh, to look up and live by faith. So by faith, Lord Jesus, we want to touch the hem of your garment. By faith, Lord Jesus, we want to stretch out and believe, Lord Jesus, that you are the Savior of the world. So help us now, Lord Jesus, those who have been sick, those who are sick and facing all kinds of illnesses and things, Lord Jesus, that come upon us. But Lord Jesus, you said you were the healer. If we believe in you, you are the deliverer. If we trust in you, oh, you are the lifter up of our heads when we become discouraged. And we just say, thank you, Lord Jesus, today. Help us now. Oh God, help all those who are trusting and believing you. Help all those who are looking up to you, who are proclaiming that you are Lord and Savior. Bless our pastors today. Bless the First Pentecostal Family Worship Center. Bless our family. Lord, bless our virtual family, those who are listening, oh God, who are connected to us in the name of Jesus. Bless those who are confined, those in hospital, nursing homes, in facilities, Lord Jesus, institutions. Help them now. Let them know that you have not forgotten them. They are not forsaken in the name of Jesus. And Lord, help our country. Help our nation right now. Bind the hand of the enemy in the name of Jesus. Bind confusion and destruction. But oh God, bring peace, Lord Jesus. Bring peace to our minds. Oh God, as we trust and believe in you, help this world, Lord Jesus, because we need you as never before. And oh God, we just will give your name the praise, the glory, and the honor, because you deserve it all. And we say thank you, thank you. In Jesus' name, amen.
Amen. What a powerful prayer on today, a prayer of a faith, but I really believe it's a prayer of hope. What our expectation is on today, and that is the Lord is going to step in. He's going to bless us, and whatever we are facing, we're facing it together, and we're going to continue to let our light shine. It is not simply our light, but it is the light that Christ gives us, and he shines through us, and because of that, others will see the hope that can only come from a relationship with Jesus Christ. From the word of the Lord today, Missionary Powell is going to share the word of God, and then we're going to prepare our hearts for the word of life. I tell you, God has a word for us on today. Come on, missionary, and read the word to bring us into that place, praise God, where we are ready to go forward. God bless you, evangelist.
God bless you, pastor. We're going to be reading Hebrews chapter 10, starting at verse 16. This is the covenant that I will make with them after those days, saith the Lord. I will put my laws into their hearts, and in their minds will I write them. And their sins and iniquities will I remember no more. Now where remission of these is, there is no more offering for sin. Having therefore, brethren, boldness to enter into the holiest by the blood of Jesus, by a new and living way, which he hath consecrated for us through the veil, that is to say, his flesh. And having an high priest over the house of God, Let us draw near with a true heart in full assurance of faith, having our hearts sprinkled from an evil conscience and our bodies washed with pure water. Let us hold fast the profession of our faith without wavering, for he is faithful that promised. May the Lord add a blessing to the reading and the hearing of his holy word.
Thank you, Evangelist. What a wonderful passage of scripture encouraging us and letting us know that we have been forgiven. A way has been made, a new way. Praise God. And that way is Jesus Christ. By the shedding of his blood, we have a new covenant with our Father through Jesus Christ. And thank God for that passage of scripture as we prepare for communion on today. I want to remind you that today is Communion Sunday. This is the time that we set aside to come together as a body of believers to worship the Lord in holy communion. At this time, we're going to call for Pastor Hess Sr. We want to say hello to you, Pastor. God bless you.
God bless you, Dr. Hess. Praise the Lord. Thank God for you on today. Listen, I was waiting on some praise and worship, but I say you're ready.
Oh, I'm sorry.
Ready today. Come on, I'm ready as well. Hi, Missionary Evangelist Powell, and to all of you that make up our congregation at the First Pentecostal Family Worship Center. Thank God for you. Thank God for those of you that are persevering and you're moving forward, and the Lord is blessing. Just want you to know that you absolutely have our prayers. We pray for the congregation every day, sometime during the day. We pray during the day, sometime in the afternoon, even in the evening. We pray for the membership that the Lord has blessed us. We also thank God for our virtual listeners on today. May the Lord bless you real, real good.
God bless you, Pastor. Thank you. I tell you, you turned a year older on Friday, but you still got it, Reverend. I appreciate you on today. And, you know, God is just good. He's just he's good. Amen. And we're just going to let's go on into praise and worship, and we'll come back to you, Pastor. How about that? God bless you. Let's go into praise and worship. It's your time. It's your season to give God praise because he's our everything. God bless you. We'll be back.
God is my everything.
I said God is
everything. I know that he's my hope.
He's my hope.
Yes, he is.
Tomorrow.
I said he's my rock.
He's my rock.
In the weary land.
A shelter in the time of storm.
Hey, I said God is.
God is.
God is.
God is.
I said God is.
God is.
My everything.
God is.
I said he's my joy.
God is.
He's my hope.
God is.
He's my rock.
God is.
I said God.
God today. That is a powerful song on today. God is my everything. I tell you, he's not just one thing, but he's my only thing. He is my everything. He is my way in, my way out, and he's my way through. And we thank God for you on today. I tell you, we've had a praise and worship. The choir has even sung today. That's one of our choir songs that we love to go to when we want to just give glory to God and really let him know that he is our everything. Come on back in, Pastor. We're going to bring you in on today. And we're just glad to be in this time of communion. I tell you, the seasons, the months are just flying by. But I thank God that we have a constant that we can remember the death, the work of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ, that he would humble himself and come to redeem mankind and to rise again. And I just thank God for that opportunity, and just thank God for you on today. God bless you, Pastor.
Thank you, sir. I appreciate the saints of God and those of you that are part of our congregation. We are doing this labor of love, and we're doing it to you, to help you so that you can be blessed during this unusual season that we're in. And we just want you to know that we're here for you and that we're praying for you. I think I'm ready to get into the word on today. So I'm going to read the word of God right now. In the book of Hebrews, the 11th chapter and verses 24 through 28, I'm going to read these passages of scriptures. It says, by faith, Moses, when he was come to years, number one, he refused to be called the son of Pharaoh's daughter. By faith, Moses, when he had come to years, he refused to be called the son of Pharaoh's daughter. Step number two, choosing rather to suffer affliction with the people of God than to enjoy the pleasures of sin for a season. Step number three, esteeming the reproach of Christ greater riches than the treasures in Egypt, for he had respect unto the recompense of the reward. By faith, this is what Moses did. He forsook, or he refused Egypt, not fearing the wrath of the king, for he endured as seeing him who is invisible. Through faith, Moses, he kept the Passover and the sprinkling of blood, lest he that destroyed the firstborn should touch him. Thank God for the reading of his word on today. And one more passage of scripture, book of Hebrews, the 12th chapter and verse 2 on this communion Sunday. And I'm going to try to put this together. Looking unto Jesus, the author and the finisher of our faith, who for the joy that was set before him, what did he do? He endured the cross. He's despising the shame and is set down at the right hand of the throne of God. May the Lord continue to add a blessing to the reading of his word on today. I want you to stick with me, track with me on today. I want to talk to you on this communion Sunday about giving God pleasure. Giving God pleasure. This message on today, I thought about there's so many bad choices that's being made these days, and I want to just take my time and not rush through here, but I want to also talk about the good choices, such as the choice that Moses made. Moses, he had to refuse before he could actually choose. So the problem is not always found in our bad choosing. Choosing is not the bad thing, but the main problem is in our not firstly being willing to refuse. Moses, before he could properly choose, he had to first learn how to refuse until there is a correction in our ability to refuse or to turn down the pleasures of sin. We'll be making mid-course corrections all the days of our lives. There's a commercial on the television. It's an insurance commercial. You've seen it. It's a horror commercial. And on that commercial on television, the theme is making good, healthy insurance choices. That's what they're talking about. But I got something out of that commercial. It's been around now since about 2014, where you see quite a few young people, they're running in the darkness of the night as if they were being chased, when they suddenly look up and they see a haunted house out in the middle of nowhere. And one of the young people said to the others, while they were panicking, "Why don't we hide in the attic of the haunted house?" The other young person said, "No, why don't we hide in the basement of what appeared to be a haunted house out in the middle of nowhere, right in the middle of the night?" And they're making choices like, are we going to hide in the attic or are we going to hide in the basement of the haunted house? The other young person sensibly responds and said, "Why can't we just get into the running car?" It was a convertible. It was sharp, full of gas. I'm sure it was full of gas. "Why can't we just make the right choice and get into the running car?" And then another one of the young persons, they responded and said, "Get into the running car. Are you crazy? Let's hide behind the chainsaws." All of these are bad decisions except the right one. And they're talking about hiding in the attic, hiding in the basement, hiding behind the chainsaws. Someone then said, "That's a good idea. Let's go hide behind the chainsaws." But to end all of the madness, after the man that's standing there, who was supposed to be part of the haunted house, he shakes his head because he can't understand why they're making such bad choices. And then they come out from behind the chainsaws, and finally the commercial ends, and they're running off into the darkness. Come on, let's run for the cemetery. All of those were bad choices except the one. They run past the running automobile with the keys in it, the car running. They could have easily made the right choice, but instead they chose to run into the cemetery. Stick with me on today. I'm trying to go somewhere during this time of COVID-19. The purpose of the insurance commercial is that when you are in a horror movie, you can make poor choices and you can make poor decisions. That's what you do in a horror movie, is what they said. That's a current screenshot of the reality of today's society during this current season of uncertainty. Listen, there are so many wrong decisions that's being made. And it's puzzling how we have to try to wrestle with people to try to understand why are people so willing to be a high risk and to transmit, this COVID that's out there. When you look at the life of Moses, I'm going to get into my scripture on today. When you look into the life of Moses, Moses' life can be viewed in three distinct parts. I learned this from Dr. Hess. in looking at the life of Moses, it seems that his life was divided into three distinct 40-year sections. The first third of Moses' life as a prince in Egypt could have been shaped by his self-effort and by his self-achievements while he was there in the palace. He could have made all of his decisions for his personal pleasure. But the second, or the middle part of the life of Moses, life was spent as an assistant shepherd in the desert of Midian. It was shaped by isolation and insignificance. So he went from being in a place of being set for the throne to a place of isolation and a place of insignificance. But the third, the final portion of Moses' life, which is what we celebrate, which is what we read about, what we preach about, it's even in movies and all kind of things, we find where Moses is now having faith in God and humility before God, and he's obedient to God so that he cannot please himself, but that he could please God. He wanted God to get the pleasure out of his life. Dr. D.L. Moody, Dr. Hess tells me that he described it by saying Moses spent his first 40 years thinking he was somebody. He spent his second 40 years learning he was a nobody. But then that last 40 years of his 120 years, he discovered what God can do with a nobody who is willing to give God pleasure. It's very interesting to see at this point in the life of Moses, where most of us, if we had been in the position that Moses was in, we'd be ready for an easy chair. We'd be, you know, just looking to do some things that we want to do. But Moses was just now hitting his stride. He was just now getting ready to become effective after 40 years, where he was ready to give God some pleasure. Somewhere between the cradle and the grave, we have to come to ourselves and say, not our will, but thine will be done. Moses, at a specific time, he refused, the Bible says, to be called the son of Pharaoh's daughter. When Moses understood that growth and maturity did not come immediately, it took Moses 40 years to make that decision. But Moses concluded that over his entire lifetime, that the Spirit of God was grooming him and correcting him and building him up into the image of Christ. When you read those scriptures that I just read on today, we find in the Old Testament where Moses, he was also and already thinking about Christ that was going to come. He did not know who Christ was like we know him today, but God gave him a revelation and told him that he needed to get his life in order and that he needed to begin to not just prepare to give himself pleasure, but to give God pleasure. Bad choices can be found all the way throughout the entire Bible. I'm not going to deal with a lot of the bad choices, but beginning in Genesis, go all the way through Revelation, we see where bad choices are everywhere from the front of the cover of the Bible to the end of the Bible. We see where all decisions carry consequences. All decisions also carry results. Starting out in the book of Genesis, the third chapter in the sixth verse, just stick with me just a little while. I want to talk to you. When the woman Eve saw that the tree was good for food and that it was a pleasurable, enjoyable delight to her eyes, and that the tree was desirable to make one wise, after she had been warned of God not to touch of that, Adam had been warned not to touch of that, they both unwisely took from its fruit and ate, and they both unwisely, they ended up falling right there in the Garden of Eden. It came because they were not trying to give God the pleasure. They were looking for pleasure for themselves. In the book of Genesis, the 12th chapter, verses 10, 11, 12, and 13, says, now there was a famine in the land. Listen to this next word, so. Listen to this word, so. So Abram went down to Egypt to sojourn there, for the famine was severe in the land. It came about when he came near to Egypt that he said to Sarai, his wife, see now, I know that you are a beautiful woman, and when the Egyptians see you, they will say, this is his wife, and they will kill me. but they will let you live. So he told her, said, please say that you're my sister so that it may temporarily go well with me because of you and that I may live on account of you. So he was thinking about his own pleasure. He was not thinking about others that could be harmed by his bad choices, by his bad decisions, by not wearing a mask, by not social distancing, by not watching out for other people. In the book of Genesis, the 13th chapter, verses 10 and 11, Lot lifted up his eyes and saw all the valley of Jordan, that it was well watered everywhere. This was before the Lord destroyed Sodom and Gomorrah, like the garden of the Lord, like the land of Egypt, as for you to Zoar. Here's that word again. So Lot chose for himself all the valley of the Jordan, and Lot journeyed eastward. Thus they separated one from the other. We find out whenever there is a bad choice made, you'll find the word so. I discovered that in my studies. When you find bad choices in the, let me go to Genesis, the 16th chapter, verses 1, 2, and 3. Now, Sarai, Abraham's wife, had borne him no children, and she had an Egyptian maid whose name was Hagar. Next word, it says, so Sarai said to Abraham, now behold, the Lord has prevented me from bearing children. Please go into my maid. Perhaps I will obtain children through her. Abraham listened to the voice of Sarah. After Abraham had lived 10 years in the land of Canaan, Abraham's wife, Sarah, took Hagar, the Egyptian, her maid, and gave her to her husband, Abraham, as his wife. When you look in the book of Exodus, you find where people have always made bad choices because they were not thinking about pleasing God, but they were thinking about pleasing themselves. In the book of Exodus, stick with me, Exodus 32, 1 through 4 says, now when the people saw that Moses delayed to come down from the mountain, the people assembled around Aaron. They surrounded him and said to Aaron, come, make us a God who will go before us. As for this, Moses, the man who brought us up from the land of Egypt, we do not know what has become of him. They turned on Moses and they turned to Aaron because they were not trying to please God, they were trying to please themselves. Aaron unwisely said to them, tear off the gold rings which are in your ears of your wives, your sons, and your daughters, and bring them to me. Here's the word. Then so all the people tore off the gold rings which were in their ears and brought them to Aaron. I think you get the picture on today. Listen, somewhere between the beginning of our salvation and the time the Lord calls us home, we have to transition to a place where we are ready to be found giving God pleasure. Moses, the Bible says, he refused to be called the son of Pharaoh's daughter. He said he's going to not accept to live the life of the Egyptians any longer. And so the Bible says that, number one, he had to refuse. Many times people are struggling. People are wondering, why is it? It's a term I like to use. How come? Every time I seem as if I'm making some progress, how come? Seem like I'm struggling all over again. When I choose to do right, nothing happened. It's because we're trying to choose, but we have never firstly stopped to refuse the things of the world and the things of Egypt. We're struggling in many cases because we're trying to choose to do right, but we have not slammed the door and refused the things of the world. You find all through the Bible, you find where people are wrestling and people are making mistakes. Here in November of 2020, you know, it's just puzzling to see all of the things, even in the sports world and the World Series the other night, the Los Angeles Dodgers, they were in their final game to win the World Series. And right in the middle of the game, in the seventh inning, I believe it was, they came and pulled him out of the dugout because he had tested positive for the coronavirus. But then right after the game was over, you find himself right out on the field with all of the other teammates with no mask on. Listen, I'm not criticizing. I'm just saying that we're not making the right choices in many cases. We have to think higher. We have to think long term. This is what happened to Moses. Listen, Moses, he could have just thought about himself. Moses actually should have been dead. Moses never should have gotten through his infancy, really, because there was a decree that was out there to kill all of the male children. But God came up with a plan, and God honored Moses' life. And Moses' mother put Moses' mother and father put Moses in some bulrushes and put him in the Nile River. God preserved him, where they were talking about throwing all of the children into the water, but God came up with a plan to preserve Moses for those first 40 years while he was there in Egypt. But he did not want Moses to keep that same mind and that same heart of the Egyptians. Listen, saints of God, people of God, I know that many people are anxious. I know that many people don't know exactly what to do, but I want you to know that during this downtime that we have got to make sure that we're giving God pleasure. Listen, there are a lot of pleasures that are not necessarily sins, but they're pleasures that we enjoy, and we put those pleasures over the pleasures of giving God pleasure. Our job, listen, you get more out of withholding pleasure for yourself and giving God pleasure. You get more out of life in the latter part of your life than you would if you did not give God the pleasure. Listen, Moses could have become the next king. He could have been on the throne, no doubt, because the king did not have any other sons, didn't have any sons. And Pharaoh's daughter didn't have any sons, didn't have any children. And so Moses could have possibly been the next king. But Moses, the Bible says, when he came of age, he was 40. When he came of age, he refused to be called the son of Pharaoh's daughter. Things happen. Crisis happens in life. Crisis come to allow us to know the character that we really have on the inside. When crisis come, God has a plan for the people of God. When crisis come, God is expecting us to move on up a little bit higher and say, not my will. The Bible even talked about the crisis that Jesus went through. That's why I read that scripture, who for the joy that was set before him, Jesus understood that he could have called for 10,000 legions of angels. He could have called down for angels from heaven to come and to destroy them that were going to apprehend him and take him to the cross and crucify him. But the Bible says, who for the joy, we have to think ahead. We cannot think in the past. We have to think ahead. We have to prepare for what's coming. Now is the day of salvation. Oh my, listen, I read this word on the other night and I was troubled. I didn't know what to call it. I didn't know what to deal with this part, mainly about we have to learn how to refuse before we can actually choose. And the Lord just woke me up and told me that it's time to tell the people that we need to give God the pleasure. Some of the pleasures that we're giving ourselves, we need to give God those pleasures. Sometimes we don't want to give God pleasure. We don't want to give God his honor. We don't want to give God his due. And that's what many people are struggling with. They're struggling with, I want to go back to the things that please me. I want to go back to the things and the ways that they were before, when I could go golfing, when I could go fishing, when I could go to work, when I could go to church, when I could wash my car, when I could be around my family. Listen, none of us like this day that we're in. But the fact of the matter is that God has allowed this day to come to us, and we've got to learn some lessons from what God is trying to tell us. And I know that God is, when you look at the life of Moses and how Moses, the first 40 years of his life, he took on the things of Egypt, but he learned how to build pyramids. Oh, yes, he learned all of the things of the Egyptians. The Egyptians were skilled. God anointed him while he was there in the palace. God elevated him while he was there in the palace. And while this COVID is on a rampage even now, listen, God is raising you up. God is preparing us so that when this thing is over, we're going to give him all of the glory. We're going to give him all of the honor, and we're going to give him the praise. Matter of fact, we're not going to wait till the battle is over. We're going to give it to him right now. We're going to come up higher. We're going to do the things that are pleasing to God. There are some bad choices that people made. I've touched on this recently in the book of Acts, the 5th chapter, verses 1 and 2. It talks about a couple by the name of Ananias and his wife, Sapphira, and how they sold a piece of property and kept back some of the price for themselves. They were giving themselves pleasure. And with his wife's full knowledge and bringing a portion of it, he came and laid it at the apostles' feet. In the book of Acts, the 24th chapter, verse 27, says, but after 2 years had passed, Felix was succeeded by Porcius Festus, and wishing to do the Jews a favor, Felix left Paul in prison. That was a bad choice. Listen, people are making bad choices today. You have got to ask God to show you, to lead you, and to guide you. Even in the book of St. Matthew, we find where one of the 12 named Judas Iscariot, he went to the chief priest and said, what are you willing to give me to betray him to you? And they weighed out 30 pieces of silver and gave it to Judas. From then on, Judas began looking for a good opportunity to betray Christ. That was a bad idea. And you find the results of what happened to Judas, not because he was trying to please God, but he was trying to please himself. The Bible says, examine yourself and see if you're in the faith. When you read there in the book of Hebrews, what we were reading on this message on today in the 11th chapter, we find the word by faith. It's by trusting. You have to trust God in every situation. You've got to learn how to trust him. When things are not going well, you've got to trust him. When you get a bad doctor's report, you've got to trust him. When your money is low, you've got to trust him. And so when you look at the word of God, you find out that trusting God and giving God all of the glory, it does not matter what the season is. If you put your trust in Jesus, everything will be all right. I want you to know today, my friends, that you got to give God pleasure. He desires the pleasure of his people. The Bible tells us that we are his people. He loves us. He cares for us. He wants the best for us. But he has a process. He has a procedure for us to receive the blessings that he has for us. If you be faithful over a few things, he'll make you ruler over many things. In other words, if you be faithful over the few things that are pleasing to God, he'll make you ruler over many things. There are three pivotal points, and I'm going to be done for today, in the history of Moses that's recorded in the word of God. And we see the transition. Moses got to the place where he had to make an intentional and a deliberate choice of what the rest of his life was going to be like. Each of us, we come to a place in life where we have to decide how we're going to invest in our tomorrow and invest into our future. The history of Moses is very interesting. It's very instructive. It's history. And you find all of those things in the Old Testament scripture, how we remember the life of Moses and how Moses was that man that was able to get close to God. Somehow between the time when Moses was pulled out of the Nile River and things were turned over to his mother, his real mother, to take care of him, and how he was raised by his mother, and his mother began to teach him and to counsel him about the difference between Egypt, which Egypt typifies and represents the world, and his heritage. And some of you today, you're running from the Lord. But I want you to know that we've got to stop giving ourselves all of the pleasure. We must begin to turn to him. The writer said, I came to Jesus just as I was. I'm going to close it out. Weary, worn, and sad. But oh, that's not the end of it. But I found in him a sweet resting place, and he has made me glad. Listen, if we begin to give God pleasure, we'll find out that he will bless us exceeding abundantly above all that we can ask or think. God bless you on today. Listen, I'm going to have a prayer. I'm going to say a prayer with somebody on today. Those of you that's listening that have not been giving God all of the pleasure that he deserves, he's worthy of all the honor. He's worthy of all the glory. He's worthy of all the praise. Those of you that are outside of the ark of safety, I want to pray a prayer with you right now so that you can, from this moment forward, begin giving praise and honor to God. I'm going to pray for you. Just bow your heads. Father, in the name of Jesus, Lord, we thank you for this word on today. We thank you, Lord, for this victory that you have given us, that we have been able to bring this word to the people of God on today. Lift up the bowed down head. Help those that need to have you in their hearts. Come into their hearts right now and live forever. Touch those that are backsliders. Give them another opportunity. Help them to say yes to your word, yes to your will, and yes to your way. In Jesus' name we pray. Thank God. Amen and amen. Begin giving God pleasure. God bless you, Dr. Hess.
God bless you, Pastor. What a timely word to encourage us, but also to challenge us. And I was thinking of a quote that I heard one time, and it simply says this: life is a sum of our choices. Wow. And there are transition lessons within our life. And I think we find ourselves in a great transition time, even on today. I want to bring in a missionary Powell because, Pastor, that was a seasoned
yes, word. Amen.
A word that came from wisdom, comes from a place of understanding God. You're almost there, Reverend. You're almost ready for your third season of your life on today. But I was looking at that, and I want to go back to Exodus 3. You were referring to it, but you did not specifically quote that passage of scripture.
Yeah.
But in that third chapter, the Bible says that the bush caught Moses' attention.
Yes.
Because it never stopped burning. Mm-hmm. And mm-hmm. when I have read that for so many times, but I heard someone say just last week that it really caught my attention that perhaps the bush was always burning even before Moses saw it. But it was in that time of transition that he actually saw the bush, which represented the call of God. As we're in this transition, Pastor, I believe that the bush has been burning for a long time, but the bush is still, it's coming into focus now. And will we choose to please God? Why is it so important to please God? And I want to ask that of Missionary Powell on today. Why is it so important that we please God? And then I want you to help us out today, Pastor. God bless you, Missionary.
Praise God. It is important that we please God. You know, the Bible talks about ourselves. In our own flesh, there really isn't any good thing because we become self-centered. We focus on what we want. But we realize, we need to realize why are we here? What are we doing? We're here to give glory and honor to God and not just focus on what we want. Because God says he was going to give us what we need, but we're so focused on what we want and what we want to do that people think that they're giving something up, that they're giving away their time, they're giving away what they want. And I just thank God because he will provide all we need. He will give us the things that are important. We look at things as being important, but they're really not that important. You know, what do we want to do? What does our flesh say? How do we want to be compensated? But God said, if we would just look to him, we don't have to worry about the other part, giving God pleasure. And it's something about when you give God pleasure, it uplifts you. You know, as for instance, if you're always focused on me, I'm going to do this for me and mine, that's very narrow. But if we really focus on God doing what he wants, if we focus on trying to please God, that's really going to elevate us to a higher level. Because what does he do? He requires something higher out of us, higher expectations, higher form of living, the higher things in life. If we really focus on pleasing God, it will move us to a higher plane.
That's wow, that's great, Missionary Powell. You know, while you were talking there, you can be doing something for many, many years, but the Bible says in the year that King Uzziah died, or Uzziah, some say, I saw also the Lord. He had been doing it for a long time, but he had not really been pleasing God. He had not really been focusing on God. But as he began to focus on God, he said, I saw also the Lord. He was high and lifted up, and his train filled the temple. Then that's when he began to examine himself as Moses did and say, woe is I am a man of unclean lips. I dwell in the midst of an unclean people. He said, but now my eyes have seen the Lord. And so when you began to give God the pleasure that he desires by lifting him up and esteeming him and putting him first, and instead of saying, Lord, this is what I want you to do, the question ought to be, Lord, what wilt thou have me to do? And that comes when we give pleasure to God.
Thank you all so much for those words on today to help us to understand why it's important that we please God. And I want to close this segment out. We can bring all three of us back in, but I want to close this segment out. As you all were talking, I want to go back to that Hebrews, the 12th chapter and the second verse, Pastor, that was your part of your foundational text on today, who for the joy that was set before him. Jesus gave us the greatest example of pleasing God. When he pleased God, there was joy on the other side.
Yes.
And so many times we want happiness, which is based upon happenings or based upon our circumstances. But whether we're having a good day or not, oh, if we're in the pleasure of God, we can experience the joy that can only come from him. Somebody says it's joy unspeakable and full of glory. The glory of God, building ourselves up for the capacity to receive the glory of God. That's what Jesus did, Pastor. That's what Moses did. He walked into his destiny when he realized that he had to give God the pleasure. Pastor, I think sometimes that God allows challenges to come in our life so that we can get, as missionaries said, we can get those things that we think are important out of the way. And we can then really focus on what God's purpose is for our life. And I believe that God, in this season, God is speaking to us that he has a purpose for us, Pastor. And that purpose is that we would give him pleasure. Lord, have mercy. I tell you, Reverend, you got me excited up in here because God is so great. Thank you for the word of God. We've got to keep moving. It's now time for a communion, and we're going to prepare ourselves for communion.
Were you there when they crucified my Lord? Were you there when they crucified my Lord? Tremble, oh.
Don't you feel the presence of the Lord?
Hallelujah.
I feel His presence. He is so real. And we're preparing ourselves for communion. I want to say just a quick word of prayer as we come into this part of our service on today. You have had time to get your bread and your juice, and we're going to ask for God's blessings upon this portion of our service. Father God, we thank You that You have sent Your Son, and we thank You for the shed blood of Jesus Christ, for refusing, for humbling Yourself, Lord. We thank You, Lord, for thinking of us more than thinking of Yourself, for dying on the cross and shedding Your blood and redeeming mankind by the shedding of blood. There could be no remission or forgiveness of sin. For that, we are grateful, and we thank You for rising again for us. God, we ask You to bless us as we celebrate this communion, that we would reflect and we would remember and gain greater joy, greater perspective of who You are and what You've already done for us. We ask this in Jesus' name. Thank God. Amen. The word of the Lord: for I have received of the Lord that which also I delivered unto you, that the Lord Jesus, the same night in which He was betrayed, He took the bread. And when He had given thanks, Lord, we thank You, He brake it and said, take, eat, this is My body, which is broken for you. This do in remembrance of Me. Praise God. May take your bread and eat your bread. After the same manner, also He took the cup when He had supped, saying, this cup is the New Testament in My blood. This do ye as often as you drink it in remembrance of Me. Praise God. For as often as you eat this bread and drink this cup, you do show the Lord's death till He comes. Drink ye all of it.
Hallelujah.
Thank God for communion. Praise the Lord. Thank God for the service of communion on today. And I tell you, we have been blessed through the word of the Lord, giving God His pleasure, giving God pleasure. And I thank God for you, pastor and missionary, for being with us. Come on, bring them back in one more time. And amen. We want to close out, but we're entering into the voting season. We just want to talk about that for 30 seconds here. We want the people of God, if you haven't voted, amen, to make sure that you vote. Amen. Vote as if your life depended upon it, because I believe that our lives are in a balance. You know, we really can't trust man. Our trust is in God. But even in this season of voting, we're asking you to pray one more Monday. We've been praying all the Mondays, and I just feel led that we should continue to pray and just pray for peace, that God would give our land peace, because peace can only come from God. Yes. We have often said, and I believe, Pastor, you have been preaching messages of hope for this last 6-7 months. And one of the words that keeps coming up is peace. People need peace. And why is peace so important in this season? And where do we get our peace from? We're going to close out with that question on today. I tell you, because we need peace. Come on, missionary, and then Pastor, you can share, and then we'll come back and close it out.
Amen. Peace is important. It talks about the peace of God, which passes all understanding. And many times when we don't understand, we have unrest, we're unsettled. And it's important for us to be able to be settled in our spirit. When people don't have peace, they can't sleep, they're uneasy. Amen. And so it's important to ask God to give us peace in our minds, peace in our hearts, because we don't, many people, their hearts are failing them. And they have so much anxiety, it brings on many illnesses and sicknesses. But we have to really ask God to give us the peace that He gives.
God bless you, Missionary Paul. That's wonderful. You know, the peace of God, as you said, which passes all understanding. Peace, you know, means shalom. And when you have the shalom of God, when you have the peace of God, when you have the power of God in your life, then it will cause you to rest. 37th Psalm says, don't fret yourself because of evildoers, because their time is not going to be long. And we just have to pray. Then we have to rest in the Lord, not fear, but we have to rest in the Lord. Everybody, make sure that you vote.
Thank you so much, Pastor and Evangelist. We close with that word on today. The word is rest. We want to rest in the Lord, and we want to trust the Lord and believe that God is going to bring us through. And we're believing and we're praying. We are people of faith, and we pray the prayer of faith that God will touch and God will deliver. Until next time, we want you to stay safe. Most of all, to continue to trust the Lord. And we want to thank you for sending your letters, sending your tithe and offering to the ministry. You know, we don't talk about it a lot, but it's because of you that we're able to continue the ministry. It takes a lot of resources to share the word of God on a consistent basis. We are on 24/7 through the radio and also through the internet. And I thank God for you. You can write to us at P.O. Box 164, Bottle Creek, Michigan, 49016, and continue to pray for us as we pray for you. We're in this together, but together we are going to make it. And until next time, may God richly bless you, and we will see you on Wednesday night. God bless.
Thank you for joining us. We pray this service has been a blessing to you. We invite you to join us next Sunday for the power of Pentecost. Have a blessed week.